Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee in 2017. Can I ask everyone, including the public gallery, to please switch off their electronic devices or switch them to silent so that they don't affect the committee's work this morning. Before moving on to our formal business, we understand that today is likely to be Gail Ross's last meeting as a committee member. Can I put on record my thanks to Gail for her work this session? Item one, our first item today is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Do members agree? Thank you. Item two, we will now take oral evidence on the Auditor General for Scotland's report entitled The 2015-16 Audit of NHS Tayside from Lesley, McLay, Chief Executive, Professor John Connell, Chair of the Board, Lindsay Bedford, Director of Finance, and Andrew Russell, Medical Director and Deputy Chief Executive of NHS Tayside. Before I invite an opening statement from NHS Tayside, I want to put today's evidence session into some context. We last took evidence from senior officials in December to seek an assurance on their ability to manage the very serious financial challenges facing NHS Tayside. Since then, the picture has worsened in some respects. In December, NHS Tayside projected an £11.7 million deficit for this financial year, which would be met by loans from the Scottish Government. It did not anticipate any impact on the level of services provided. The Scottish Government has since confirmed a further £1.5 million of loans for this year to avoid the prospect that NHS Tayside would otherwise require to take cost-saving action which would impact delivery of patient care. That was the Scottish Government's words. NHS Tayside has asked the Scottish Government for a further £4 million loan for next year. Indeed, that sum is already included in its draft five-year plan. That would take NHS Tayside's overall loan debt to over £37 million. However, it is not clear whether the Scottish Government will grant this £4 million. And staying with the next financial year, £5 million of the £45 million savings that NHS Tayside has to make is classed as high risk, and £12 million identified as medium risk. We do not know what that means for ongoing service provision. In December, NHS Tayside told us it fully anticipated repaying all Scottish Government loans over 5 years. Its five-year plan now apparently shows £2.6 million of loans still outstanding at the end of that period. In December, NHS Tayside told us the Scottish Government thought its five-year financial plan was credible. However, we now know that the Scottish Government is asking for independent assurance on the ability of the transformation programme to deliver the change required. In February, the Scottish Government told us that NHS Tayside is to receive £8 million annually for the next 4 years, which was not in its previous plans. All this, it has to be said, is within the context of NHS Tayside also having to make efficiency savings of around £175 million over the next 5 years. And finally, we know that senior Scottish Government and NHS Tayside officials met this Monday and that one of the issues for discussion was whether patients in NHS Tayside could face longer waiting lists. Now, that is a brief summary of the current position. We will, of course, explore all these issues in depth until we are completely satisfied that NHS Tayside has a grip on the situation. And I'd like now to invite an opening statement from Professor Connell.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, I can thank the committee for the opportunity to make an opening statement. I know, as the Convener has outlined, that there are a number of issues you will want to cover this morning, and I and my colleagues will answer these questions transparently. And with that in mind, I will keep this statement brief. 2016-17 has been a pivotal year for NHS Tayside, and one in which our staff have continued to demonstrate their absolute commitment to high quality, safe and effective healthcare services for patients, their families and the communities. Our financial plan for 16-17 will deliver just over £45 million of efficiency savings for the whole system. This has been challenging, but our priority in that period has been, as always, that we will seek to ensure patient safety and patient experience. In that regard, I can assure the board, the committee, that our performance in terms of waiting times and patient experience has been maintained and in many instances improved over the last year. Very brief examples: we have an improved position on our 31-day and 62-day cancer targets, a much improved position in terms of delivering alcohol and drug treatments. We've maintained our position as the highest performing board in Scotland for 4-hour waits in accident and emergency. And indeed, when we compare our position with the other major teaching boards in Scotland, we're either first or second in 12 out of the 17 national standards. As you would expect, we have been in regular dialogue, and you've confirmed that, with the Scottish Government Health Department regarding our forecast outturn for this year and the future. And on the basis of these discussions, I can confirm that we have agreed to seek further brokerage of up to £1.5 million. That's in line with the forecast that Mr. Gray gave you when he appeared before the committee in February. We have worked very hard over the last couple of months to ensure that there has been no impact on patient care and patient services, and it is against that backdrop that we agreed to seek the additional brokerage. Our difficulty in fully closing the savings gap reflects ongoing pressures on the challenge in reducing the level of delayed discharges within our system, which lies some way outside our full control, and on cost pressures in our prescribing budget. Put it into context, the sum of 1.5 million equates to 0.18% of our annual revenue resource. That's not to minimise the sum, but to put it into context and demonstrates the margins against which all health boards operate. We have submitted to the committee our 1 year, the operational draft delivery plan and our updated 5-year transformation programme, and we're happy to answer detailed questions on those. We have already acknowledged that we will require the continued support of Scottish Government, and it is my understanding that Mr. Gray has agreed that he is willing to sanction up to £4 million of additional brokerage for the ongoing financial year in question, 17-18. In addition, the board is very happy to welcome an assurance advisory group that has been agreed with the Scottish Government that will work with NHS Tayside to provide advice and assurance on our 5-year transformation programme. We believe that is a positive step. The wealth of experience of those in the group, led by Sir Lewis Ritchie, whom I have already spoken to, will bring further external perspective to the planning and delivery of our transformational programme. Against the scale of the challenges we face, we acknowledge the group will bring additional capacity and will support our staff who work hard to deliver day-to-day care and treatment for patients, families and their communities. Lastly, I can give you my assurance, as I did at the last appearance in December, that the board remains committed to returning to financial stability. I think I said at the time that that was a long stage plan. It will not be achieved overnight. That remains the case. In addition, I also gave an assurance around our position relating to patient care and experience, and I would like to place on record now our commitment to ensure that the people of Tayside should be aware that our staff will continue to deliver safe, high quality and effective care. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Connell. I'm going to open with the first question. I outlined in my opening remarks some of the financial pressures and loans, brokerage and debt facing NHS Tayside, but you appeared in the local press in December just before Christmas saying there would be no impact on patient services. Can you make that guarantee now?
I can confirm that financial pressures have not had an impact on patient services. I'm happy to give examples of that, but we have not changed services as a result of financial pressures. Clearly, services have to change that reflect other pressures: availability of beds, pressures of delayed discharges, ability to recruit and retain staff. So patient services always reflect those pressures, but they have not been modified as a result of financial constraints.
But that's over the last 6 months. I mean, you made that statement on the front page of the Evening Telegraph in December. It's now March, even less than 6 months. We're looking at a 5-year plan here that NHS Tayside has put in place with, as I said, no guarantee that all the loans can be paid back. Can you guarantee that over that 5-year period that there will be no impact on patient services in NHS Tayside?
I think it would be foolish to give you a guarantee for 5 years on anything. I cannot account for what our budget will be in 5 years, and that will depend on national and international financial changes. I can't give you an indication of what Tayside's budget will be in accurate detail in 5 years' time, but to the best of our ability, we will maintain and support patient services as appropriate within the financial envelope that we have.
So that guarantee that you made in December, what was the timescale of that guarantee?
The guarantee that I gave in December was that based on what we were doing at the present time, and in the foreseeable future, which, generally speaking, in the function of an NHS board is within a one-year period, we can predict exactly what resource we have to spend and how we will spend it. We will maintain patient services as efficiently and as effectively as possible. Patient services will change as appropriate in light of the National Clinical Strategy and the document from the Chief Medical Officer, Realistic Medicine.
So that guarantee was valid for the first year of the transformation plan?
I don't think it's appropriate for me to give you a time limit and a guarantee. I'm guaranteeing that the board will do its utmost to maintain patient services within the financial resource available.
Paul Gray said when he came to this committee on the 9th of February that it was, I don't know if he used the word inevitable, that patients would have to wait longer in NHS Tayside for treatment. Is that the case?
This has not been the case.
Could it be the case over the next 5 years?
The likeliest impact on patient waiting times, I suspect, will be our ability to attract appropriate high-level consultant staff to deliver those services. Our biggest waiting time at the moment, I believe, is in urological surgery. That reflects a difficulty in attracting consultant urologists to Scotland and to Tayside. That is not a financial issue.
Okay. But could other waiting lists be impacted by the financial situation?
I will ask my medical director to comment further on this, but my understanding would be that at present we do not see an impact on waiting lists based on our financial situation, but clearly our ability to attract staff, retain staff and manage our bed complement will be impacted by that. So pass to my medical director.
Before Mr Russell comes in, but Paul Gray does see that there is going to be an impact. Andrew Russell.
So I would reinforce the view from Professor Connell that changes to our clinical services will reflect our ability to embrace contemporary clinical practice and to embrace an evidence base that says that we should be offering different range of services to patients with different outcomes. That is not principally driven by the financial concerns, but will be driven by our ability to offer best outcomes within the resource we've got available.
So, Dr. Russell, do you think that there will be an impact on patient waiting times in NHS Tayside as a result of this financial situation?
I don't see there being an issue that is directly related to the financial position because, as Professor Connell has stated, the determinants of our ability to deliver are determinants around work, principally around workforce, and our ability to be in a position to have particularly the consultant staff available to provide the interventions that are counted as part of the treatment time guarantees.
Why do you think Paul Gray thinks that patients will have to wait longer as a result of this situation then?
I wonder whether, and again I can't speak on behalf of Mr Gray, and you may wish to come ask for further detail from him on that. I would say that the position we find ourselves in is one that the availability of the workforce will be the principal determinant of our ability to deliver our service, and that will be focusing particularly around outcome.
Thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. I've read through the year one and year five plan here, and I have to say there's not a lot of solid indications here as to how you're actually going to achieve the savings that you occasionally pepper throughout the document. It's more a declaration of intent than a pathway to achieving what you're looking for.
Do you wish me to comment on that or is that a question?
Well, I'd be interested to get your views on that.
Firstly, I would suggest the five-year plan has, by necessity, got to be a long-term vision, and I don't think any health board in Scotland could give you a five-year plan that had very detailed delivery of services costed over a five-year timescale. A one-year plan is different, and I do believe that in the one-year plan, we have outlined the key areas where we see savings being made.
You've outlined
key areas, but you haven't gone into it in any depth. I mean, I'm still none the wiser as to how you're going to achieve the actual efficiency savings that you're talking about in each area. It's just declarations of intent.
As a board, I think we have struck a balance in producing a plan that is not so detailed as to be unreadable, but gives indication as to where the savings will arise. But I will ask my chief executive, Lesley McLay, to give you comment on the granular detail of where the savings are.
Thank you, Chairman. So, Mr. Beattie, our plan is a draft plan, and we will obviously be submitting this formally to government tomorrow. The plan has been built up through the services, through our clinical leads, our general managers, our professional leads, and underneath each of those service areas, there are detailed plans. It was key for us in the one-year plan to get the planning principles right. And those planning principles have determined the risk assessment that you will see that's within the plan in terms of high risk, medium risk and low risk. As a board, we are discussing with government in particular our high risk areas. And we're also expecting to work closely with the assurance and advisory group on the detail of those high risk areas. So I think in summary, what I would say is we do have detailed plans that sit underneath each of the service areas. We recognise the importance of working with Scottish Government and the group that will be supporting us in a bit more granular discussion around the high risk areas in particular. And after that, we will then intend to publish the plan formally.
Given the undoubted seriousness of this, this committee back in December asked for detailed plans. What you've given us here is a sort of a, as you said yourself, sort of headlines.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no way we can look at this and say, oh, well, you've got a decent plan in place that's going to work. We can't. It just doesn't do that. You call it a draft plan. Who have you consulted on this plan?
Well, this plan has been put together with our frontline staff and our managers and our clinical leads within the organisation. The plan also reflects the strategies that the board has already approved. And so we have detailed plans for older people, for mental health, for our planned care on scheduled care. And what you're seeing is the kind of summary of the areas that we will be delivering in 17-18. But I can assure you that there are detailed plans sitting underneath it. But because it's draft and because we recognise the importance of the risk assessment, particularly in the high-risk areas, then there's further work that we will be doing jointly with Scottish Government. And our intention, certainly in our board discussions over this month, has been that we would then formally have that back at our board in our May meeting.
You mentioned consultation with staff. Have you had consultation with the unions and other stakeholders?
Yes, yes, indeed.
But, and they support this?
If I may pass to my chairman, who did the conversation yesterday, our Area Partnership Forum, in relation to the plan.
Yes. The Area Partnership Forum has considered our financial framework twice over the last month. So in the first instance, the Area Partnership Forum considered the financial framework against which the plan has been developed over the next year. So they are aware and have approved the notion that we have to find savings across the board in our acute sector and in our partner IJBs of the order of magnitude shown in the plan. The draft plan that you see now was looked at by the Area Partnership Forum yesterday, which I attended. The Partnership Forum jointly agreed that it wished to work together in partnership to produce the final version of the plan, which will be agreed finally by the Scottish Government. So it is a partnership document.
Would it be possible for the committee to see more detailed plans on this, see what's underneath this? Given that, you know, given this is a very serious situation and we have to ensure that we have understood the full position that you're in.
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, just recognising that there's still draft and there's probably some... I mean, we recognise the importance of the role that the group that are coming in, the assurance and advisory group, and the challenge they will bring to that. So that clearly will be happening over the coming weeks. But the draft plans are there and we'd be happy to support you with that information.
Now, in response to a question from the convener, you said that patient care would be unaffected by any of this going forward. However, on page 11 of your one-year plan, you say, for our patients, this means removing any elements of their care pathways that do not add value to their experience or outcomes. Can you give me an example?
I think probably I will ask the medical director, Russell, to answer that, but one area where we're clear that there is cost that is inappropriate within our patient service relates to our pain pathway, and that might be a good example.
I'm happy to give you additional detail, Mr. Beattie, around that. So if we were to look to the way in which we offer services for people with for pain within Tayside, we are particularly dependent on the use of medicines and the use of a tertiary service around our pain clinic. If we were to compare ourselves with other systems, there are a greater range of alternatives available within the community and a greater range of alternatives available to the use of medicines. As we move forward, we will put less emphasis around the use of medicines and we'll put greater emphasis around the use of some of the alternatives.
Here you're saying removing elements of their care pathways, not moving to alternative medicines in order to save money. It says removing elements of the care pathways. So can you give me an example of what you would remove?
So we would, with respect to that particular pathway, we would remove elements of the prescribing which we do not think add the level of value and outcome with regard to the patient's experience, and we would be seeking to invest in other areas of that pathway in order to bring about better outcomes.
So you would be removing drugs that you felt were not... I mean, are you over-prescribing at the moment?
We're not over-prescribing, but we find ourselves in a position that we have less of a focus around some of the alternatives to the use of medicines and some of the health board systems. If you look to the evidence as to what produces best outcome for people in terms of quality of life and ability to function and return to the places of work, it is a much broader set of interventions and something that simply focuses on the use of medicines. Historically in Tayside, we have had a particular focus around our pain pathway, working with our tertiary pain service.
I'm still not very clear about removing elements of the care pathways. We'll park that for the moment. Do you have any benchmarking in respect of your costs versus other elements of the NHS, other boards? Do you track that? There's no mention of that in here.
Absolutely, we do. We have cost comparisons and benchmarking across a whole range of areas. In that we're on prescribing at the moment, that might be a good area to stick with. Where we do have very accurate, updated benchmarking on our prescribing costs across a range of indicators of chronic complex disorders, such as diabetes, chronic respiratory disease and asthma, atrial fibrillation, that's irregularity of the heart, high blood pressure. And I'll perhaps ask my medical director to expand on that benchmarking that we have.
So with regard to the six most common chronic disease areas that we have in Scotland, we're in a position now to look at those disease areas from a cost perspective in terms of the cost of the medicines prescribed to each individual patient rather than a nominal amount allocated as was undertaken historically. We also know that the prevalence, the level of disease in the community at any one time that's being treated is different in different parts of Scotland. In Tayside, in 12 of the 16 areas, we are at the top end of levels of disease that are being treated in our communities. And we benchmark that against the chronic disease registers that are made available for the quality and outcomes framework from general practice. What that means is that we are in a position around those chronic disease areas that our cost per treated patient is comparable and in fact is lower than the majority of Scotland. But when you take into account the fact that we have more patients requiring treatment in those areas, we have significant cost pressures. So if we were to have the same level of prevalence as the rest of Scotland, that would take £3.5 million off our prescribing budget.
Just coming back to this document, I have to say that there's nothing here that convinces me you're going to reach your target, which is why I'm quite keen to see some more detailed plans. And the indications, as the Convener said earlier on, is that the Scottish Government also has some reservations about whether you can achieve what you're proposing, in view of the fact that they're looking at having an independent review, which I think is quite prudent at this point. Has that review started, or is it...
No. The Scottish Government agreed the members of the review panel with us on Monday. The members of the review panel were contacted on Tuesday. I spoke to Sir Lewis Ritchie, who will lead the panel this morning. I spoke to Steve Logan, the chair of NHS Grampian, yesterday afternoon. Paul Hawkins, who's the third member of the panel, has been in contact with our chief executive. Lewis Ritchie anticipates that the panel will meet together for the first time, probably early next week, and will then begin to engage with NHS Tayside.
Is there a, is there a target date for completing this review?
3 months.
3 months. Okay. Well, we'll await the outcome of that, and hopefully we'll get some more detailed information here, which will give us some reassurance on this document, which at the moment is fairly weak as far as I can see. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Beattie. In addition to the assurance group that the Scottish Government has put in place, have the Scottish Government given you any extra managerial support in terms of people going into NHS Tayside to support the work you're doing here?
Yes. In the recent weeks, we had an independent review carried out by Dr. Gregor Smith, who's a Deputy Chief Medical Officer and a General Practitioner with an expertise in prescribing. So he has already been in and has worked with our prescribing management group and has actually looked at our prescribing costs. He's submitted a report to Mr. Paul Gray on that, which I have now seen. That report essentially concludes that our analysis over our cost pressures is correct. He identifies that we have areas of high cost that are accounted for by what the medical director said was the increased disease prevalence, where our cost per patient is actually often lower than the benchmark. But he also confirmed our view that we have areas where we do need to contain costs, particularly around chronic pain, and that is an area that he recommended we focus on. He also confirmed our view that we need to institute a Tayside formulary to constrain the choice of drugs available to general practitioners, and that again is a work in progress.
So in addition to Gregor Smith's review on prescribing, has the Scottish Government given you any, have they seconded any staff to NHS Tayside to support you?
I'll ask our Chief Executive.
I'll pick that up. So over the last 12 months, we've had support in terms of subject matter expertise from NSS Scotland. We've had some programme management support around our transformation programme, and then we've had individuals who've come in to specific programmes in terms of like our catering programme, our outpatient work that we're doing. So we've been fortunate, and we've welcomed that opportunity, and it's created additional capacity for our staff who clearly are delivering the frontline job as well as doing the planning and then the redesign as well.
Have they seconded anyone to your level at management to support the work you're doing specifically?
No.
No. Okay. Thank you. Ross Thompson.
Thank you, Convener. I have a supplementary question to your own line of questioning around about the evidence from Paul Gray. So just to go back to this question on waiting lists. Paul Gray advises committee that reducing treatment rates is one of the contingencies that NHS Tayside had raised with him as part of improving your own financial situation. And I'll quote you what he said to the committee. That's what I want to discuss with them, whether and how they will deploy some of these contingencies. There may be some that are appropriate and some that are not. I just want to be sure about that. The convener, does that mean longer waiting lists? Yes, let's not beat about the bush. Of course it would. So in that spirit, is this a contingency that you have discussed with them? And two, what other contingencies are you looking at to help improve that financial situation?
I'll ask my chief executive to comment further, but in brief, we did discuss with Mr. Gray whether we could control costs in the short and longer term by essentially taking actions that would result in longer waiting lists. We felt that was inappropriate and he agreed, and therefore we did not take those actions. Those actions would include closing theatres, reducing operation availability time, and making patients essentially wait longer for necessary surgery. We believe that to be inappropriate, and we still do. So our challenge is to find ways of saving money without impacting on patients in that way. I don't know if my chief executive
wants to add. The only other point I would make would, if you looked at our 16-17 plan and where we have invested money, NHS Tayside, in fact, over the probably the last 3 years, has put on mobile theatre capacity onto the site in Nine Wells. And that was just in recognition of we were trying to bring all our work in-house, obviously, and take out our private sector work, which we did. And that cost to the organisation is probably somewhere in the region of £1.7 million. So that was a commitment we made in 16-17, and that has allowed us to hold our performance, particularly around some of the access targets. It would have been an option, but it was an option that we weren't prepared to take.
So, obviously, significant savings have to be made. I'm just trying to tease out exactly what the negative impact is going to be on the quality of care and the performance as well as a result of that. So I'm just trying to find out what sort of alternatives and contingencies you have discussed with Mr. Gray, and if you could enlighten the committee to what those are.
I'll start off and then again pass over to Lesley McLay. If I could firstly just make the observation that other health boards have made decisions to take savings and have impacted on patient waiting times. So our outpatient waiting time has been held stable. Other health board waiting times have gone up very substantially. So there are decisions that health boards can make. We chose not to impact on patients. There are other savings we can make, particularly around day case surgery, making surgical patient access more efficient. And again, I'll ask Ms. McLay to add to that.
So that is a key feature of our 17-18 plan. So Mr. Beattie talked about benchmarking, and we've been looking at the productive opportunities that are there within the organisation, working again closely with Scottish Government colleagues, and also using the discovery tool. That's a national tool that's available, and that allows us to look at the performance in every other board in a whole range of areas. So in terms of our planned care service plans for 17-18, we have set targets to increase the number of day case surgery. We also, there are areas where we need to improve around our pre-operative stays, and that's a productive opportunity, because by doing that, it means people come in on the day of surgery, and that allows us to reduce our bed days, and which has caused pressure in terms of bed numbers, etc. So we do have, in 17-18, quite a number of those opportunities that will drive the efficiencies without impacting on quality of care.
Okay. So I suppose actually looking for the guarantee that the convener was looking for, and following on from Professor Connell's own remarks, we are being told today that given the significant savings that have to be made, the significant amount of money that has to be paid back in debt, there will be no impact on patient care and quality of care. So you're saying that to the committee today and also to the public today.
Yeah. Can I perhaps expand on that? As far as is within our power,
As much as we can we have a direct answer to that question?
Yes, I'm going to come to that question. As far as is within our power, we will give that guarantee, but there are factors that are outside our control. Over the last, at present time, we have 60 blocked beds in Perth and Kinross alone. That means that we cannot have access to surgical beds for patients in the way we would like. If we could have those patients not in NHS beds, but as they should be in the community, we would be able to deliver much more efficiently on our financial targets and on our patient waiting times. So it is that factor rather than finance that constrains us.
The implication there, Professor Connell, is that's an issue for Perth and Kinross Council and the IJBs.
That's an issue that has to be solved in partnership.
Yes. Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Convener. It appears to me that NHS Tayside is still very much in financial distress, but we've heard in evidence today that patient experience and waiting times remain fine. I want to return to staffing. Colin Beattie touched on it earlier. At the committee's meeting in Dundee in December, we heard from local trade union representatives, and it wasn't a pretty picture at all. They raised some serious points. Looking at these draft plans, I know you've said, Professor Connell, that the Area Partnership Forum was consulted yesterday and everyone is on board, but there's going to be a real pressure on staff to try and achieve this transformation, which you say is vital. So can you give us more detail about the consultation and what partnership actually looks like on the ground? Who is on the Area Partnership Forum? And did anyone at all raise any significant concerns which echo what we heard in December about low morale?
Okay, I'll pass to Lesley McLay to give you a full answer on that. But I was at the Area Partnership Forum yesterday, and obviously staff partners are concerned about the impact of the financial plan in terms of what will this mean for staff, their job, their jobs, their ways of working, how the savings will be delivered. And so the Partnership Forum agreed that this would be developed jointly with them. As our Chief Executive said, this plan is an evolution and therefore it will be developed as a partnership. It will be owned by the Partnership Forum. In terms of consultation and relationships with our staff partners, I'll pass to Lesley McLay.
So the Area Partnership Forum met yesterday. Were they seeing the draft plans for the first time at that meeting?
That was the first time that document had been seen. The board saw it for the first time on Monday, but the Partnership Forum had seen the financial framework and the financial underpinning of the plan earlier in the month.
Okay, just to continue that. What's key to the success of this plan is the leadership that we get, not just from our clinicians and our managers, but also the leadership from our trade union partners. And the board, a number of months ago, took a further step to enhance that. And that is now that the Area Partnership Forum members and the Area Clinical Forum members of NHS Tayside are actually core members of our senior leadership team. So that was to move us forward, not just in terms of having our Area Partnership Forum monthly meetings and our consultation, but actually getting them into the heart of the actual build and looking at the performance of the organisation. And I think already I can see the benefits that we're getting from that. So there's something around owning that plan rather than just getting to a point where you're consulting upon it, and we will continue to build on that.
Let's look at some of the detail. On page 40 of the five-year plan, you mentioned extended hours of working for additional clinic capacity at weekends and evenings. Do you think this can be managed within your current staffing complement, and have unions raised any concerns on that particular point?
Excuse me. Sorry, page 40 in the one-year plan.
Page 40 of the five-year plan.
Okay. Sorry, I apologise. I've only got my plan. I've only got up to page 32 in our five-year plan.
Well, the issue is in relation to extended hours of working.
Yes.
To,
okay.
Increase clinical capacity at weekends and evenings. So what have the trade union said on that point? Are you confident you can manage that within your current staffing complement?
So 7-day working has been a key feature for the board over a number of years, where we've increased our access to diagnostic services so that patients are getting timely access at weekends, where our AHP services in particular, and often over the winter months, are actually there. They develop kind of rosters where we have our staff rostered over a 7-day period. So that development is something that is core to the board and we will continue to work with. Of course, in any of those changes, we would do full consultation with our staff and that would be done in partnership. But there clearly are a number of areas where we would strive to provide provision over 7 days.
Okay. On page 16 of the five-year plan, you also say that more of the same in relation to your staff cost base is no longer a viable option, and that will involve a reshaping of the size and grade mix of your workforce. Does this mean cuts to staff numbers?
It doesn't, and I think I did talk at our December meeting in relation to that. So we do recognise that our workforce base is higher than what you would expect, and we are clear that that's driven by the number of hospital sites in particular, and I think I referenced the fact we had 26 hospital sites. So through natural attrition, in terms of either retirements or people leaving through the introduction of technology, there are just ways of how we can reprofile the workforce, which we're doing with them. There's an example that we will be able to change from the beginning of April 17-18 on what we've done this year, and that's around our theatre workforce. So recruitment to theatres is quite a national challenge across all health boards, and we've worked with our staff where we've actually reprofiled roles and we've created a kind of band 4 role which wasn't traditionally there, and that allows other skill mix that we have to focus on particular duties. So in some areas that redesign actually could be the creation of new roles. We've also got a strong apprenticeship programme in NHS Tayside across a whole range of services, so we are looking innovatively to see see how we can reprofile and make sure that the staff with the right qualifications are doing the right job.
Okay, how many apprentices do you have?
12. Yeah.
And how many do you expect to have by the end of the 5-year transformation plan?
So I don't have that information available to me, but I could certainly get that back to you.
One other question, I guess, is what will this reshaped workforce look like in 5 years' time in terms of numbers? Is it going to increase, decrease, stay the same?
Again, at the end of 5 years, I think it's probably quite difficult to predict the shape and size of the workforce, partly because of the change in health and social care integration, because clearly much more care is going to be delivered in the community with a different type and grading of staff. So I can't tell you absolutely now how many staff will be employed by NHS Tayside directly, how many will be employed in the care sector through either third sector or other employers. I wouldn't anticipate a major change in the number of staff employed in core services, but the type of staff may well be because of changes in technology, changes in medical practice. So it would be foolish for me to say there will be no change in the total number of staff. It may be higher, it may be lower. And the distribution of staff between hospital and community undoubtedly will be different.
Okay. Perhaps we could look at agency staff. In previous sessions in this committee, we've looked at the 39% rise in spending on agency staff, which I think you'll all accept is extremely high. Lesley McLay, I think you said in the last meeting that the number of nurses on your nursing bank has increased from 800 to 1,200 nurses. Can you give us an update today on what the profile looks like, and has use of agency nursing increased or
sure,
is it more manageable
now? I'd be happy
now?
To do that. Our nurse bank numbers have increased. In fact, I think the number I saw over the last week was taking us into the region of about 1,300 nurses that are on our bank. We've also instigated a survey with nurses who've been recent leavers, and also having been able to secure a return to practice accreditation programme with the university in Dundee, we're looking to target people back into the practice. So we're not resting on our laurels in terms of the numbers we have at the moment and continue to increase it. In terms of the nurse non-contract agency, we were and still are a relatively high user, but I can advise the committee that overall our use in 16-17 is down 22% on what it was in 15-16, and that has given us an efficiency saving of just under £1 million. So through better recruitment into our nurse bank, through better rostering policy deployment, we have been able to reduce our reliance. And that is a key feature of our 17-18 plan, that we will continue to look to reduce our reliance on non-contract agency.
Okay. So what lessons have been learned in terms of the circumstances that led to that spike, that huge increase in spending on agency nursing? You know, it surely didn't happen just by accident.
When you track back, and I have to say it's been quite complex to really understand that, because up until about 2013 we were a very low user, so there's been about a 3-year increase. I mean, part of it undoubtedly reflects the challenges in terms of nurse recruitment, and also we are working really hard to understand the flexibility that our staff want and look to see how we can deploy employment contracts for them that are as family friendly, and recognising, I think, also the age profile of our workforce, which we have quite a high proportion going into the 50 to 60 age group, and looking to see how we can again create a kind of work plan for them maybe in the last 5 years to support their continuation in employment. So it's something that we will continue to work hard at over the next 12 and 18 months.
So you think you've got it under control now?
I think it's definitely improving, and I think the reduction of 22% I think it is significant, but I'm not complacent in terms of our position. I think our overall use has now come back into somewhere about sort of 10% of overall NHS Scotland's use. Is that correct? Yeah.
Last year, for the whole of Scotland, we probably accounted for about 23-24% of the nurse agency, non-contract agency spend. If I look at where I expect to finish this year, I expect to be around about 15-16% of Scotland. But if you look at the month of January alone, then Tayside was at 10% of Scotland. So it's very clear that the action that we've taken since December is changing that pattern. pattern of use.
Okay. I mean, you've talked us through before savings that will be realised through the disposal of surplus assets. Indeed, you've talked about what will happen over time as hospitals close. I see from the update that we've had that you've managed to sell a couple of properties since we last met with you, including the Murray Royal, £550,000. Is that what you expected to get for that property?
Bedford, I think.
It's lower than the original estimate from a couple of years ago. Okay. But
what's that, Mr. Bedford?
I think, as we all recognise, with all property sales, it is open to market forces. Mm-hmm. The Murray Royal, as with all property sales, it is complex. It had a historic Grade A listed building on it, and clearly the market for picking up these types of sites, recognising this probably significant investment that developers will have to make, kind of markets the limits that market.
I understand the pressures on developers and development finance, but I just wonder what you were expecting, taking all of that into account, what you were expecting to get for that property.
Yeah, the original estimate was around about £1.5 million.
£1.5 million, okay. It's just I don't know that site. I'm not local to Tayside, but when I looked at it on Google last night, it looks like a rather large site. I think it's about 21 hectares, so it did seem someone's getting a bargain. On that, I think when we spoke to Paul Gray, it was confirmed that any money you get from these properties, it's not going to be sort of clawed back centrally. So I'm just wondering whether asset sales have been used to offset brokerage so far and how much this has amounted to.
Again, I think Mr. Bedford is best placed to answer that in detail.
At this stage, it hasn't offset any of the brokerage. We've used it to assist the in-year financial position. So in this financial year, probably close to £2 million will assist the financial position to get to the
13.
So that was agreed with the Scottish Government.
Okay.
And that's the proposal that we put to Scottish Government for the next two financial years as well.
Right, okay, so any future asset sales in the next 2 years won't be used to offset the brokerage?
It will be used to assist delivery of the overall efficiency savings.
Okay, thank you. I think just one last question in the spirit of transparency, Professor Connell, which you touched on at the beginning. I just wondered, in advance of today's meeting, has the committee received any coaching from any external advisers?
No.
No, but you did last time.
We took advice. I wouldn't have called it coaching.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask about the high-risk efficiencies that are identified in the financial plan for 17-18? The one-year plan says that you'll fall £4 million short, and you've already indicated, Professor Connell, that Paul Gray has indicated that he might be willing to pay that, but you also state that £5 million of your savings there are high-risk. What does that high-risk mean?
Okay, and again, I'll pass that to Mr. Bedford, but overview would be that high risk are often areas that we feel are not fully within the control of NHS Tayside in terms of managing the expenditure. So part of that be within the impact of delayed discharges, where we have not the ability to deliver on that absolutely on our own. But Mr. Bedford, I'll give you further detail.
Yeah, there's probably two or three components to the high risk initiatives. We touched on prescribing earlier. We recognise the initiatives that we are implementing. But to implement that in full in 2018-19, then we recognise that there is a risk. That's not to underestimate the amount of work that is going on. You're aware when we spoke in December that there were five key actions that we were pursuing. The new formulary will come into place on the 20th of April. I think we'll probably need time to understand what the actual impact of that will be, and Dr. Russell may wish to comment further. So prescribing is one element of the high risk. The second element is that, as the member mentioned, there was the level of agency costs. So within our local delivery plan, the Scottish Government are expecting us to identify ways of reducing agency spend, non-contract agency spend, by 25%. What we certainly keen to do in Tayside is to have stretch that further to make sure that the impact of non-contract agency on the overall system is less. We recognise that may be inhibited by recruitment challenges and some of the pressures on the service. So that's another element of the high risk. Another element.
I can see the breakdown, Mr. Bedford. I think my question, the breakdown prescribing accounts for nearly 2 million of the high risk savings. My question is not where does the breakdown come, but what does high risk mean that you're unlikely to make these savings? Presumably there is a risk that you won't make these savings. That's what high risk means. I think that's what you're saying. So what would happen if you didn't make those savings?
I think what we've always foreseen is that, like any plan at the start of the financial year, there is an expectation that through the work that's going on the individual programmes of efficiency, that they will move from high into medium into low, recognising the actions that are taken. I think what we recognise with the high risk ones is that the actions aren't entirely within our control. So
the biggest chunk of this is 1.9 million on prescribing. I mean, that is completely within your control, is it not?
You point out the majority of prescribing costs are incurred in primary care. Primary care lies within the control of the IJBs.
Right, okay.
Now, we work closely with the IJBs. We have a prescribing management group, but it is still a partnership.
But they only fell under the jurisdiction of the IJBs very recently. I mean, until about a year ago, they were part of NHS Tayside and presumably were led by policy from NHS Tayside in terms of prescribing. Are you saying that you really have no control over GP prescribing now?
No, I'm not saying that, but I am saying that there's now a partnership in place and we have to work within the constraints of that. But I'll pass to Professor
Russell. So does the partnership increase the risk for the budgets of Tayside? Does the partnership with the IJB increase the risk for NHS Tayside's budget?
Undoubtedly, in terms of our ability to have delayed discharge patients moved out, yes, it does.
But in terms of prescribing as well?
Pastor Professor Russell.
So with regard to the prescribing, I do not see a specific risk, as you've identified, Convener, with regard to the new arrangements and the prescribing. But if I can perhaps give you an example.
I think Professor Connell identified that.
Could I maybe give you a specific example that might help try and get us around some of the high-risk elements? So if I was to give you an example of a specific medicine, which is a medicine that's used for cholesterol, which should be used as a sort of third or fourth line medicine, when that medicine has been looked at elsewhere, there's been about a 25% of those patients have been seen to be inappropriately on that medicine. We've used that as our assumption. We've reviewed 1,200 of the patients, and less than 10% of them are getting that medicine further up in terms of first or second line. But so the risk is around the fact that we've taken planning assumptions from experience elsewhere, and our experience locally may or may not reflect that. That's why they fall within our high-risk element.
Okay, but would you agree with Professor Connell that actually the new governance structure with IJBs makes this saving of 1.9 million a high-risk saving?
I perhaps would let Professor Connell just clarify exactly what he meant by that, Ms. Maher, but certainly from my perspective, I don't see the new arrangements directly impacting upon that.
My comment was principally in relation to delayed discharges, where it is undoubtedly the case that the IJBs have a key role to play in helping us move patients from acute hospital sites into the community. Undoubtedly, prescribing budget now is within
IJBs. Professor Connell, you said that now GP surgeries have moved to IJBs.
That is true.
And that was in response to my question about the high risk.
Well, I apologise if I misled you. I didn't mean to. But there is no doubt that primary care is now within the IJB. The primary care prescribing budget lies within the IJB budget. So the saving that is set against prescribing within family health prescribing is against the IJB. And therefore we need to work in partnership with the IJB to achieve that saving.
But you said you don't have complete control over that because it is now in the IJB, but it's within your budget that it becomes a high-risk saving. So I think what you're saying is the governance structure is actually making NHS Tayside budgets more precarious?
I perhaps ask my chief executive to comment on that too, but there is undoubtedly an added complexity in that we now have three IJBs with three separate budgets, which are derived from NHS Tayside and from the local authority. And therefore the governance of that does become more complex than the governance of a single unitary health board. That's undoubtedly the case. But that's the chief executive.
Yes, I wouldn't disagree with that. And I think, as you indicate, convener, we are just closing out year one of the new governance arrangement. So we, as a system, if you go into our one-year plan, our planning principles are that we will work as a whole system. Our transformation programme is whole system, and that crosses all the services that are devolved into the integrated joint board partnerships. But yes, there is a layer of complexity that is now there that we need to ensure that we work through.
On these savings as well, there are no savings identified at all on regional working opportunities. But you will have read, as I did in the Courier yesterday, about the situation, about the exchange of information between NHS Fife and Tayside, and there's a lot of duplication in that process. Presumably, that is a cost, that duplication is a cost to NHS Tayside. So why is that not identified as a saving in this table?
Pass to
yeah.
Ms. McLay.
So I'm not sure in terms of the actual specific of what the duplication you're referring to is, but what I would say is we're not reflecting regional working at this stage just because of the maturity of the regional plans. There will be a big focus this year to build a regional local delivery plan, and we are working collaboratively with both the North of Scotland boards and the boards in the South East region as well. So I think that is emerging in terms of development, but we are not, because I think it would be high risk at this stage, got specific initiatives with a high level of confidence that we would look to deliver efficiencies in 17-18. In our service plans, you will note that there is a section that talks about regional or national perspective, and that's either to reflect some of the national initiatives or reviews that have been concluded. So one would be the National Burns Review that will go to implementation, I believe, over the next 6 to 12 months. So there are initiatives coming through both at national and regional that will feature in our plan, but they're not there concrete enough in terms of our confidence to take efficiencies from our budget.
Can I say on that? I mean, there are obviously big savings you can identify, but obviously every small saving makes a difference as well, given the situation that NHS Tayside is in. And I hear from constituents as well that there are cost savings that could be made. For example, Action on Hearing Loss, this project to fix people's hearing aids in the community. NHS Tayside this year has refused to fund that, despite the fact that it's evidence, independent evidence, projects that it would make £87,681 of savings for NHS Tayside in the audiology department. So why are these proposals being blocked when the independent evidence shows savings like that? I can share this paper with you.
I'd be more than happy if you would. And I think in relation to that, I mean, our service plans are built up from our clinicians and senior managers in each of our specialist areas. So I don't have the detail on that, but I'd be happy to look at that.
Mr. Bedford.
Probably just to give a bit of clarity, I think we've touched on earlier that we have to submit a draft local delivery plan by tomorrow. It is a draft. I think that recognises the regional planning and delivery of services work that will go on. And we've been asked to submit final local delivery plans in September of this year, which will look for regional planning and delivery aspects to be more fully developed. So there will be more aspects that we'll bring forward as part of the plan, but whether they'll have any kind of cash releasing saving in 2017-18, then that will come to fruition over the next 6 months.
Thank you. Alex Neil.
Thank you, convener. Can I just begin by just putting it on the record? In Annex B, Paul Gray says that there was never a proposal to create a for-profit agency within NHS Scotland to deal with agency nursing. That's not quite accurate, because when I was the Cabinet Secretary for Health, the then Chief Executive of Grampian was working in a project to bring the organisation of agency nursing in-house, given the cost of agency nursing and some of the big profits made by the outside agencies. We felt would have been better reinvested in the health service rather than going into the pockets of the shareholders of agencies, just for the record. Before I go into questions, can I also just put on the record, as a former Cabinet Secretary for Health, that we're not here And we're not questioning at all, and I certainly wouldn't question the clinical performance of NHS Tayside, because for a long number of years now, the clinical performance, particularly in areas like accident and emergency of NHS Tayside, has been one of the best in Scotland. So I think it's only fair to put that in the record. What we're talking about this morning is the management of the resources, particularly the financial resources. And obviously one of their concerns is to make sure that that clinical performance isn't adversely affected by how we manage this particular problem. Can I turn specifically to the five-year plan? Clearly, an objective of this five-year plan, the key objective in some respects, is for NHS Tayside to repay its brokeraging to the Scottish Government and to make significant savings. And when you add those two figures together, it means that over the next 5 years, you effectively have to make efficiency savings of £210 million, which by any standard is a substantial challenge. Can I say, when I read the financial projections in the five-year plan, I thought they had been written by Mystic Meg, because it was a bit of thumb in the air, let's hope for the best, but I didn't actually see evidence of a strategy to get to £210 million. Now, I do accept that because you don't know your budgets for that length of period of time, that it's not always possible to be absolutely precise, but that's not to stop other things happening, and I want to go on to that in a minute. But before I do, I would like to clarify a couple of very specific issues. In your opening remarks, Professor Connell, or in answer to a question earlier, you said that the savings amounted to about 1.8%, I think you said. Or
0.18. The 1.5 million additional brokerage for 16-17
right.
was 0.18% of our revenue resource limit.
Right. But over the five-year period, in the five-year plan, there are actually two figures. One is, over the five years of the plan, approximately £210 million of efficiencies are identified as being required. This equates to 5.8% of the revenue limit. But it then goes on to say this savings target incorporates over the five-year plan close to 1.3% to be returned to the Scottish Government to repay the brokerage. So just to be right, over the 5 years, we're talking about 5.8% of the revenue budget, and obviously you don't know precisely what your revenue budget, that's your estimate of the revenue budget. 5.8% of the revenue budget will be required to repay the Scottish Government the brokerage and to make the savings you need to make. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. The second point I want to clarify on page 30 of the five-year plan, because this is, I think, a bit of gobbledygook that I don't understand unless I'm missing something. It says, in delivering on this agenda, a focus on delivering a step change in mindset and focus is required that will see the organisation transform. How do you focus on your focus?
I think we have to hold our hands up and say that should have been written better. I think there's a redundant focus within that sentence.
Right, okay. But you can see why we're a bit sceptical about the plan. I just picked that as one example. There are many others. Can I raise two specific points about the plan? When you're writing a business plan, and like Mr. Beattie here, I, before I came into this place, spent a lifetime writing business plans for organisations of big organisations and small organisations. The first thing you do in any business plan is you forecast the demand for your services, because without a proper forecast of the demand for services, you don't know what it is you're going to deliver. And forecasting these days in the health service particularly can actually be quite accurate with all the software that's available. Where is the forecast? And you know, can we get the forecast for demand for your services over the next 5 years?
In brief, we do have that. We have a clinical strategy for 5 years which looks at the demographics of the population, the anticipated shift in demographics with ageing and movement within Tayside, and disease prevalence and demand for service. So our clinical service strategy is built around the anticipated demand and the anticipated change of service from the acute sector into the community. That's not embedded here within the five-year plan, but as a sister document?
I think it would be very helpful if it was embedded, actually, because when you're looking at the veracity of a plan, the starting point is the veracity of the forecast. And I think it would be helpful if we saw that, because we would then know what services you actually have to provide to meet the needs of your population. And I think if we could get a copy of that forecast, I think that would be extremely helpful. The second thing is, and I fully understand, you know, the point about you don't know your precise budgets beyond basically next year. I fully understand that point. But are you doing scenario planning? For example, very clearly, if you look at the totality of the comparative costs right across the board under each of the services, acute, community services and so on, in terms of prescribing, I would have thought clearly, and I think you've recognised to some extent, that prescribing is an area where if you were as good as the next, as the best board in Scotland, you could potentially save a significant amount of money if you're able to do that. And this is where we come back to the forecast of demand in your area. But if you're able to do that, so is there any, I mean, it's not in here, but is there any scenario planning going on that says, well, you know, if we could get to this in terms of prescribing, if we could get to this in terms of efficient use of, more efficient use of staff and agency staff, if we didn't need the number of locums that we have because they're expensive and instead had contract doctors permanently working for Tayside Health Board, I mean, is that scenario planning going on?
So the Chief Executive and Mr. Bedford around what modelling we carry out.
Mr. Neely, you're absolutely right. So when you ask that question, my response would be that there is a level of detail of that planning going on, particularly with the health and social care partnerships and the services are managed by the acute sector from the board. So I've got four chief operating officers and they are working as a collective. So there's planning that is evident in the health and social care partnership plans in the reduction of emergency admissions. And also, we've talked quite a bit already today around delivering on the 72-hour standard of patients' wait time, where those that are clinically fit are discharged to the appropriate location within 72 hours. So the IGB partnerships are saying, well, we think we can reduce the number of emergency admissions by X, and by their new home care infrastructure, home support, community infrastructure. That then allows us to look at, well, what would that mean for the bed base in the likes of Nine Wells or PRI, and how could we then redesign that bed base? And part of that will be reducing the number of beds and being able to transfer monies out to social care as well. So we're looking at emergency admissions and the impact and how we could redesign. We're looking at the length of stays, because, you know, there's a number of beds, and I think we have 119 patients just now who are in that clinically fit status, but actually are in an acute or mental health or learning disability inpatient bed. So if that wasn't there and they were delivering on the 72-hour, how could we then develop and deliver enhanced services? So I have, in the planning principles in the one-year plan, for the first time, I've put in a statement that talks about the delivery of the reduction in emergency admissions. Now I think we're quite early in that journey, but I think the new form partnerships, and because we've now got integration health and social care, I think that will allow that to mature. And I've also said, I think in terms of the reduction in the number of occupied bed days, these are things that we will then be able to take costs out, the kind of infrastructure, some of which is aging estate, and we'll be able to redistribute that money. There'll be efficiencies there, but also in terms of enhancing community primary care. So it's definitely evolving. And
can I suggest then for the five-year delivery plan to have credibility when you read the plan, that kind of scenario planning, which eventually should lead to a strategy, obviously, in each area and an overarching strategy, needs to be in this plan, because, you know, and to be fair, you know, I have the same criticism of the national so-called delivery plan. It's not actually a delivery plan, because it tells you where you want to get to, but the whole point of the plan is it doesn't tell you how you're going to get to. We won't get there by jumping in the number 9 bus in Dundee. We need a plan on how we get there. So I think you need to incorporate that for this to be called a proper delivery plan and to have the credibility. Because at the moment, as you read it, it doesn't tell you any of that. It doesn't tell you, you know, We could have written this 3 or 4 years ago about where we want to get to. The issue is, how are we going to get there? Because we haven't, to date, managed that. And what are the benchmarks? You know, in 3 years' time, what's the benchmark? 4 years' time, 5 years' time, what are the benchmarks in terms of measuring progress? £210 million is a lot of money to save. The final question I have is on the assurance group. And let me say again, you know, there's no better person than Sir Lewis Ritchie to head that. I've got the highest respect for him. But the striking thing about the three-person review group, apart from the fact it's all men, is that there isn't anyone there, with all due respect, who is a financial expert. And given this is about resources and management of finances and efficiencies and doing things better, it seems to me that that's a big gaping hole in the membership of this group. And I would have thought, convener, that perhaps it's an issue we should take up directly with the Scottish Government. But given that this is essentially a financial challenge, that not having somebody with the relevant financial expertise is a mistake, and I think we should draw that to the attention of the government and suggest that they rectify it ASAP. And I'm not talking about, you know, the internal finance structure at Tayside. I think an external person who has the relevant financial expertise and maybe, you know, resource management expertise would be a huge advantage in the work of the assurance group.
If I might just briefly comment on that, because I agree with you. I think there are two points to make. Firstly, the Chief Executive of Fife, I think, will provide a valuable comment on delivery and how that impacts on finance, because a lot of the problems relate to delivery rather than the, if you like, adding the sums up. But you're right that having financial modelling expertise would be helpful. We've discussed that with Scottish Government, and I think their proposal would be that the initial group of three might well look at where the gaps are and then recommend additional resource as necessary.
Yeah, I would have hoped that from day one you would need the financial guy, because, you know, a financial person, because quite frankly, you know, I have to say one of my criticisms of the health service is the lack of enough financial expertise in key areas. And I think this is possibly one of them. And given that this group's supposed to report within 3 months, seems to me there's no time to lose in filling the gap.
We take that up then with Mr. Gray, Mr. Neil. If I could also let you know that the number 9 bus in Dundee is a circular route, so it does go round. Traditionally been a circular route, so it does go round and round in circles. Liam Kerr.
Thank you, convener. I just want to come in briefly at this stage on something that was raised earlier. The one-year plan says that for 2017-18, you will fall £4 million short of the £49.8 million savings target. The convener looked earlier at a number of those savings are categorised as high risk, which I heard Mr. Bedford's answer earlier, but I'll take it that high risk means there is a high risk of not being achieved. So does that not mean that there's a fair to good chance that there will be even more than £4 million worth of brokerage, i.e. loans, required in 2017-18?
Well, pass to Mr. Bedford, because I think this comes down to what the word high risk means. I think in any budget scenario, one would always assign levels of risk to where savings are going to be made and categorise them as low, medium or high. And as Mr. Bedford indicated, high risk means that at present we are still developing the strategy to ensure that we will deliver within year. That doesn't necessarily imply that we think it's unlikely we'll get there. It's just that the planning assumptions are still being solidified. But I'll pass to Mr. Bedford to clarify that.
So it is exactly that. I mean, I think we touched on the high risk earlier. For me, it reflects that these are decisions that need to be taken in partnership. So I'll probably come back to one I didn't mention earlier. So part of the high risk initiatives is the delivery of the 72-hour delayed discharge target. The Chief Executive has already given you an indication of the numbers of patients that are currently in hospitals across Tayside. So there's something about working in partnership with our health and social care partners to improve that patient flow, to actually reduce the levels of delayed discharges in hospitals. But these are discussions that we're promoting right now in order to enable the significant resources that have gone into the health and social care partnerships over the past 2 years to liberate the resources out of the hospital sector. But at this stage, as you'll have seen from the figures quoted today, there are still significant numbers of patients in the hospital sector. Hospital sector, I mean, both within the acute hospital and within the beds under the control of the IGBs.
Okay, but there is a high risk that you won't deliver £5 million worth of savings in the next year. That's what the category means. Is that not correct?
One always has to accept in any budget there is a risk. And we agreed with the Scottish Government we would stratify our risk, as we have done.
Correct. But there is a risk that £5 million of the savings won't be achieved.
Yes.
And if that's correct, then the £4 million of extra brokerage you will require is lowballing.
I think that is one of the reasons why we welcome and the Scottish Government has recommended the assurance group coming in at an early stage. Because yes.
So if that's right, we've then got a category of medium risk. So what are the prospects of achieving medium risk savings?
I'll pass to Mr. Bedford to clarify that.
Yes. Yeah, so if I reflect on previous year's financial plans, there's an expectation that medium risk will migrate in the early part of the year into low risk and will be delivered in full.
Okay, so for the record, you project that over the next year you will deliver 100% of the medium risk efficiencies in this table, £12 million.
I think you'll probably end up seeing it's a bit of a mixture. I think you'll see some of the high risk going into medium and into low.
Will they be delivered, the savings?
That's the discussions that we're taking forward with the chief officers of the four partner of the three partnerships and the. And the acute hospitals unit. That's the discussions that we're promoting.
You talked about the previous years. How much of the medium risk targets were achieved for savings in previous years?
Yeah, in the main medium risk does migrate.
How many were achieved?
In terms of
100% of the savings targets that were classified as medium risk were achieved?
I don't have the figures here. I can certainly provide that information. Looking back at the early year, the plan at the start of the year and where it ended up at the end of the year.
I think that would be useful. Yeah. A final thing, and then I'll maybe look to come back later. The Scottish Government told us in February that they expect the balance, they expect you to be in financial balance by 2018-19 and to require no further brokerage. Do you expect that?
And that is the basis of our five-year financial plan. Obviously, that will depend on one or two factors that Mr. Neil acknowledged we cannot at the present time predict, because we don't know absolutely what the level of resource available will be. But to the best of our knowledge, with our planning assumptions that Lesley McLay has mentioned around 72-hour discharges, moving care into the community, yes, we will be in balance.
Thank you.
Gail Ross. Thank you, Convener. Good morning. When Paul Gray was here, I touched on prescribing with him, and I'd like to go back to that now in a little bit more depth. In the one-year plan, starting on page 14, also page 15 and 16, can you tell me who's on the prescribing management group, please?
Pass that to medical director.
The prescribing management group is co-chaired by a clinician from primary care and a clinician from secondary care, and the group has multidisciplinary, multi-professional representation, and therefore contains pharmacists, AHPs, managers, everybody involved in the use of medicines in Tayside.
We go further down the page, and it says under strategic context, there may be difficult choices and decisions ahead. Can you maybe tell us what these might be?
With regard to specifically to the use of medicines?
Well, just with regard to the context it's written in the one-year plan.
So with regard to the difficult choices around the use of medicines, we need to take cognizance of the fact that some of the opportunities to save money may be around switching patients from some medicine they're on to a medicine that is equally efficacious but is of a different brand type. And that choice, the choice to do that, can be a difficult choice because it involves a conversation, it involves a clinical consultation with the patient. It involves a level of change that people may or may not be in a position to support us with. So it's very much within the context of some of the changes that we require to make. With regards to the application of the formulary, and we've touched on earlier on the importance of having a formulary, what we don't know, and we will know over time, is that whether the level of prescribing that falls out with that new formulary and the level of prescribing that reflects individuals who have chosen to use medicines that fall out of that as a first and second choice, rather than having gone through the medicines that are already in formulary, and for whatever reason, they're not the right medicines for the patient to be taking, and therefore they're choosing an alternative medicine. And through that piece of work, we will be in a position to try and understand the cohort of patients who we will need to be in, have conversations with around potentially changing those medicines.
Okay, thanks. I understand that every patient's situation is different, and you can't just prescribe the cheapest drugs to everyone because it's not appropriate. In 2013, you did well with your GP compliance with the formulary, but you also have the highest spending on drugs in hospitals in 2015-16. So how are you looking at how the hospitals and wards are prescribing against the formulary?
So I suppose that there are a couple of things like that. We were thoughtful about the Auditor General's data that she submitted, and those data said halfway down the page that there are adjustments that couldn't be made with regard to a number of things. Now, the most obvious one for us in Tayside is that the population base uses 415,000, but we serve the population of North East Fife, which takes another 50,000 patients into that calculation. We're also a tertiary hospital, and therefore our comparator would always be with tertiary boards, because there's a different range of services provided through those tertiary boards, and by definition some of those medicines are more expensive than the medicines that would be used in a non-tertiary board. So against taking those comparators into account, we don't believe ourselves to be outliers. But with all these types of scenarios, that there is complexity within the data once you start to examine it and ask further questions around it. So that's the specific with regard to the hospital element of it all. We've done further analysis already since the Auditor General submitted those, and we think there's additional information that we will happily share that suggests that we're not the outlier in the way described. In areas where we are outliers, I wanted to pick up on, if I may, Mr. Neil's point as well, that the importance of using medicines within the context of a patient's care and the continuity of that patient's care. So we use a lot of medicines that are different to the rest of Scotland around patients who require their blood thinned, around anticoagulation. If you looked to the graphs around the reduction in stroke in Scotland, the reduction in stroke in Tayside is significantly greater than the reduction across the rest of Scotland. So there's some expense at this end that ultimately will impact upon our ability to scenario plan into the future. We are seen internationally to lead around the use of medicines for hepatitis C. And again, those are medicines that at the front end have a significant expense, but at the other end, should you not treat hepatitis C, you have patients that require liver transplantation, and our rates historically have been lower as a consequence.
Okay, as we're touching on individual drugs, what is being done to look at the use of particular drugs in hospitals, for example, statins or omeprazole or things for diabetes or other long-term conditions?
So if I was to take you back to the comments I made earlier on, when we now, and the analysis that we've only been able to get from ISD and others since December, and diabetes is a very good example, where we can look at the cost per patient treated in Tayside, we are just about the lowest in Scotland. But because we have more patients with diabetes, we have a far greater expenditure around the range of medicines around diabetes than is anticipated with the budget we are given.
What percentage of your budget goes on preventative spend?
I'd probably pass to Mr. Bedford, if I may, Ms. Ross, to answer that question.
didn't quote you a figure this morning.
Okay, could you get back to the committee on that? It's just that if you have a large number of patients with chronic conditions, it would be sensible to maybe look at how we can stop these patients getting these conditions in the first place.
So if it might may come back, I fully support and agree with that, and where our ambitions are, I think collectively around the integration of health and the social care, it should be getting into that type of territory.
I was interested on page 15. You have five challenges and quite a lot of subheadings under these challenges. When are we going to see the prescribing strategy that you've mentioned on page 14?
So the prescribing strategy work has already started and will be emerge over the summer. It begins to talk in terms, as I've tried to describe earlier on, around the use of medicines within the context of an overall disease, rather than simply looking at medicines in isolation and recognising that in creating some individual efficiencies in that budget, the totality of the spend and the outcome for patients may be poorer.
Do you think that your prescribers feel supported enough to make these changes, and how are you supporting them?
So the prescribing management group works, first of all, in very closely as almost a professional advisory structure through the area medical committee, the GP subcommittee and the consultant subcommittee, all of whom are on board and around that. We've put significant investment into pharmacy support for practices. And the Tayside was one of the first, one of the early adopters around the practice-based pharmacy model. Historically, the focus has been very much around some of the qualitative elements around that, and we recognise in areas where we cannot justify the variation, and you've touched on some of that already in the conversation, there are areas of variation in prescribing that we would very much support and would continue to support as being clinically the right thing to do. In areas where we cannot justify that, that's the type of area that we will be focusing some of the additional support.
Do you have any projections on savings if you had a bigger uptake of the minor ailment scheme?
I don't have those details. I'm sorry, it's not something that I've been party to working through. Ms. Ross, again, I don't know, Mr. Bedford, whether you have those details.
Okay.
We'll happily supply those with
for
you.
That would be good, because I know that Community Pharmacy Scotland are putting a big focus on that just now. I think there's a pilot in McLay to try and get more people in. They've certainly, the savings are in the millions, so that might be something that we could look at. On page 16, we have some efficiency savings. We've got two bottom lines of 6.2 million and 3.8 million. Is that correct? That's the two figures that I see here. In order to reach these, are there any plans to cease prescribing any items at all?
Again, I think Mr. Bedford can comment on the bottom figure of 3.8, because that's a simple impact of changes of drugs coming off patent.
That's correct. So the 3.8, over 2017-18, we expect a number of drugs to come off patent. We expect in the current year that will provide a benefit of 2.4 million.
So that's going from a brand name to a generic.
With a full year impact going into 18-19 of 4.5 million, so a further 2.1 million coming to benefit the board in 18-19. This will benefit all boards. And the other element in relation to tariff price reductions, this reflects the discussions with the contractors around the prices. So we expect a benefit that will be delivered in 17-18 of 1.4 million. And again, that's a national benefit.
But there are no plans to stop prescribing anything.
So I'll ask the medical director to comment, particularly on lidocaine patches and pregabalin.
So the lidocaine patches are medicines that are used for controlling very severe pain, and their indication is for a very, very restricted use. And whilst we have now in a position that we are complying with that restricted use, certainly within NHS England and in other parts of NHS Scotland, that use is extremely limited. Yet we have a number of patients who are getting it. So lidocaine would be a very good example of where we think it is in the patient's interest not to be having the level of access to that medicine that they have currently.
Okay.
And on the bottom of page 14, it says the realistic medicine work stream is integral to the five-year transformation programme. Can you tell me a little bit about that, please?
Realistic medicine work stream is one of our key work streams within the transformation programme. It's actually led by Professor Margaret Smith, who's the Dean of Nursing at the University of Dundee, who's got wide experience of health service delivery. She was previously head of nursing in Greater Glasgow Health Board. And the work stream is really designed to look at not only effective prescribing, but effective use of medications and effective use of interventions, and making sure that patients are offered only what is most appropriate and are not over-treated inappropriately.
Okay, thank you. And just to go back to this bottom line saving, you mentioned before on another line of questioning that there was now a split between the IGB and what they had to save through the GP practices and what you have to save with the other prescribing. Is there a split in the 3.8 million, or is that totally your saving, or is that an IGB saving as well?
It entirely relates to primary care medicine, so GP.
Okay. So just for clarity, does anyone from, who from NHS Tayside sits on any of the IGBs?
The IGBs are chaired either by an NHS Tayside non-executive member or a nominee from council. At the present time, the three IGBs are chaired by members of NHS Tayside board. Chief operating officers, two of them are employees of NHS Tayside, one is an employee of Dundee City Council, and then the IGB board is populated by nominees from NHS Tayside, who are our non-executive members, or nominees from the council, some of whom are elected councillors.
Okay, so there is relatively high influence on the IGBs, and so hopefully you'll be able to ensure that they make their savings as well.
We are, but I would remind the committee, IGBs were established as autonomous bodies.
Yes, indeed. I just hope that if the total savings are not made, that the IGBs won't be used as a scapegoat, but it's good that if you're controlling them, then that won't be the case. Thank you.
If I can pick up on that point Gail Ross was making about the IGBs and prescribing, we touched on earlier that the savings become high risk because 1.9 million of projected savings are on prescribing. I mean, is it going to be more difficult to actually get a grip of GP and primary care prescribing, Dr. Russell, because the GP practices now fall under the IGBs?
So from my perspective, I think there's less of an issue with regard to the GP practices, but there's more of issues around the governance, which we've touched on already in the conversation. We, through the use of formulary, through the agreed protocol we have for the use of medicines that fall off that formulary, and therefore the level of agreements and permissions that you need to get in order to do that, are in a position to have a confidence that irrespective of where the prescriber sits in the organisation, that the standards of the prescribing and the decisions made, which at the end of the day are made in the patient's best interest, and we're all individual, and medicines impact upon us all in different ways, there should be a degree of consistency around that, irrespective of where that prescriber sits.
Do you know how, this is an issue we've discussed before, as you know, but do you know how often GP practices review repeat prescriptions? Because there is an issue in Dundee of stockpiling medicines.
So historically, the quality and outcomes framework, which was part of the contractual obligations for general practice to work in, placed a 12-monthly requirement on medication review as part of that. The compliance with that was we determined through a payment verification model where we would sample a number of the practices and go in and check against their books and against some of the patients that those things have happened. So we have no reason to suspect or no reason to consider that that has not been happening historically.
Okay, and is there still that 12-month review target?
So that's still part of the contract, but the GP contract is, members of the committee will know, is out for, at the moment, and I'm probably not best placed to advise you as to where that medication responsibility will land in that.
How many surgeries are hitting that target of reviewing their repeat prescriptions on a 12-monthly basis?
So I, again, don't have those specific details, convener, but we have no reason to suspect, but clearly you're giving us feedback and you've given me feedback before that there's been concerns expressed directly to you.
Okay, thank you. Liam Kerr.
Thank you, convener. You need to make £210 million worth of savings over the next 5 years. We've been assured that there'll be no impact on patients and staff, and indeed in our session in December, we were quite clearly told there will be no impact on patients and staff for the savings. But this week, we've discovered that the Scottish Government has to advance another £1.5 million in brokerage, specifically to avoid an impact on care of further cost-saving measures. So what's changed in 3 months?
I think I can be maybe go back to the discussion we had earlier this morning. The £1.5 million was agreed with Paul Gray following his appearance before the committee when NHS Tayside had to look at alternative scenarios. If we wished to, if you like, close off our financial year, one of the options might have been to reduce substantially elective surgery. We could have closed mobile theatres, for example, and stepped down activity. That would have been an impact on patients. We discussed that with Mr. Gray. The board's preference was that we should not impact on patients, and therefore he agreed that to avoid that impact, he would provide additional brokerage.
Yes. You would have to take more borrowing.
Yes.
That to avoid an impact on patient care that we have been repeatedly assured is not going to happen.
Yes.
Regardless of the savings that you have to make. Isn't that correct?
Yes. I think, again, I said earlier on that when we appeared in December, our projections were that we should be able to complete the year with the savings of, as outlined in our LDP. Because of two areas of inability to achieve the savings, notably around prescribing and a high level of delayed discharges, that meant that we had maintained a level of agency in our spend and actually had to postpone some elective surgery, particularly in January and February, adding cost in the system, we did not meet our savings target. So we had added cost because of the two elements I've outlined.
I want to look at the direction of travel here. To take, I guess, a smaller example and scale it up. If we look at the five-year plan, at page 26, you talk about shifting the balance of mental health care from hospitals to more community-based. And you also talk on the same page about reviewing the larger property portfolio that you have. Now, I've written, Lesley McLay is aware of this, of course, I've written a few times regarding this Mulberry unit at Stracathro, which has been closed temporarily due to, we learned from Paul Gray in particular, staffing difficulties. So to avoid the impact on patient care, this has been temporarily closed. But isn't the implication of reducing the property footprint and shifting the balance of mental health care in this example to the community, that temporary closure is not in fact a temporary closure at all? It's a permanent closure, isn't it?
No. I think part of the issue here relates to two parallel processes. You're right that we had to close the Mulberry unit on a contingency basis because we could not safely staff three general adult psychiatry units, one in Moray Royal, one in Carsview, and one in Mulberry. And I think we explained to the committee in December and certainly subsequently that we were running major risks with level of medical staffing that we couldn't have safe rotas at night, so there was risk to patients. Because of that, we made a decision that we could safely staff two units at least until August. At present, we don't know what our staffing complement for junior doctors will be after August, so at present, we don't know what the situation will be. At the same time, and in fact, probably 2 years ago, we put in train a review of mental health services. The underlying principle of that review of mental health services was that Tayside is an outlier in terms of having more emphasis on adult inpatient care and less on community care, which is counter to current practice. And there was a strategy that we should seek to move care, where possible, into the community. It was also clear that Tayside has too many adult inpatient sites in relation to its ability to manage them safely in the long term, and we've seen that repeatedly over the last couple of years. And therefore we have an options appraisal which is currently ongoing, which is designed to look at how many units we can safely staff and where they should be. That options appraisal has yet to report. So there are two processes going on. If we come down from 3 to 2 adult inpatient sites, or even 3 to 1 adult inpatient site, there will be implications on how we deliver care for psychiatry across the whole of Tayside in terms of community care. We will not spend less on psychiatry as a consequence. What we will do is spend the money in a different way.
But will, my problem here is in the semantics, because I understand what you're saying, Professor Connell, but people have been told that this is a temporary closure. Now, temporary means not permanent. It means at some point in the future, that situation will cease to be the situation.
So that we have sufficient junior doctors to staff our rota in August, then we should try to open Mulberry again. But we have an options appraisal exercise which is coming down the track. If that option appraisal exercise, and I have not seen the outcome, if it recommends that in the long term we move from 3 units to 2, and if that implies that Mulberry is not an adult inpatient site, then we then move into the process of public consultation, formal business case with Scottish Government, and planning to establish 2 units or 1 unit in Tayside. That will take some time. So I agree with you that there is a semantic issue, but the reality is that we are having two processes that are happening at the same time, not through the choice of an NHS Tayside.
Is it possible that, just to take that example, is it possible that Stracathro Hospital could be part of the property casualties over the next 5 years? Brechin
No.
Infirmary, Montrose, could these sites be lost altogether, do you think, as a result of the review?
No. I think Stracathro is a regional elective surgery treatment centre. It also has potential to actually increase its use in community services. We run a substantial number of outpatient services out of Stracathro, and there would be no intention of moving away from that site.
So those sites, so we can tell anyone watching this, those sites will not be closed over the next 5 years.
I will not comment at the present on Montrose and Brechin because they have not been part. They're not part of the mental health review. They are community provisions. The Montrose site at present has outpatient activity and a small number of community beds. There is a need for a community bed base in North East Angus, but at present, I think it would be inappropriate to start strategically planning now the number of sites or where they should be.
In terms of the beds, do you have any, so I'm moving slightly now, have there been significant changes in the number of beds on wards in general throughout NHS Tayside as a result of your efficiency savings?
Again, I should probably pass that to my chief executive.
Yeah, my initial reaction, in terms of efficiency savings, no. But there have been a change. So, for example, one that would spring to mind would be a ward in Perth and Kinross locality, which was providing inpatient dementia care. And with the development of the community dementia model, we got to a position where we actually only had one patient in that ward. So a reducing occupancy level because of an increasing new service model that was being provided. And therefore, that ward is closed at the moment because there was no demand for it. So that would be an example of where there is there's been a change. I mean, you obviously referenced Brechin, and I know you'll have the detail around Brechin in terms of the medical care provided by the GP practice. That was the instigator in terms of that closure of the Brechin facility, although there are outpatient clinics still running from there. So in terms of direct efficiency, the answer is no, but either through service model change, or another example in Perth and Kinross would be the creation of an integrated facility of health and social care. And Dalweem is the example where we had a very old Aberfeldy hostel, very small bed occupancy, again reducing demand within there, but actually creating a new facility where health and social care colleagues are going to work under the one roof. And so I think the new service models that are coming in is changing the bed base. And as I indicated earlier, you know, looking in that planning assumption around reduction in emergency admissions, length of stay, then we should be looking for a change in our bed base within our acute sector as well.
Now, I understand there's this concept of boarding, which for someone not in it, I understand is where patients who should be on this ward are on a different ward. Have the efficiencies that you've been doing had any impact on the numbers of patients who are boarding? And how do you project that those efficiencies will impact over the next 5 years on the number of patients boarding?
So I think in terms of the boarding, that you, what you'd be referencing is normal. If it occurs, it occurs within our acute sector beds. We have a boarding policy that we adhere to, but there have been levels of boarding, and you're correct in saying that. The factors that would drive that would be an increase in expected emergency admission, so particularly in the winter period, or I go back to it, patients who are delayed within their discharge process, and therefore they are sitting in an acute bed or a surgical bed, and that if we have an emergency admission, you're in a position where you're either moving that individual patient, which would probably be the normal situation because it would be the clinicians who would risk assess who would appropriately move into a different specialty for a short period of time. So again,
no impact of the efficiency savings, the considerable efficiency savings you're making, you're saying there is no impact on the number of patients boarding.
Okay, from where I am sitting this morning, I can't think of any decision that the board has taken. I'll maybe pass to my medical director for that
The key determinant of whether or not an individual is in the right ward for their care is the level of delayed discharge within our system. Just be absolutely clear about that. So the Perth Royal Infirmary site, we, through all the predictive modelling that we do, we know can function effectively as a site that deals with the full range of services around medicine and surgery if there are 6 delayed discharges in the system. We've done that modelling. If, as we've had over the last period of time, there are in excess of 20 delayed discharges in the system, some patients will be finding themselves being cared for in an environment that's different to the ward that's not the ward that's the right one for them as a consequence of that, rather than as a consequence of efficiency savings. So just want to be absolutely clear, the key determinant of boarding in our system of care is the level of delayed discharge.
I'm done.
Colin Beattie. Thank
you. Would I be correct? I'm looking at page 30 of the five-year financial framework here. Would I be correct in saying that any financial model that at the end of 5 years is still relying on 40% non-recurring costs to deliver the savings is unsustainable?
I think we recognise that's a very challenging situation to be in. Off that 40% non-recurrent cost, our ambition obviously was, when we met in December, to say we wanted to move progressively towards 40% non-recurrent cost from the base where we're at present. It's still higher than most models would like to see.
Looking here, it says that £67 million of the savings over the 5 years will be non-recurring. Now, I see also elsewhere in your documents that the property disposals will be £12.76 million. So where's the other 50-odd million coming from in non-recurring costs?
I'll pass at that stage to our financial director.
Yeah, I think in the main it reflects the normal in-year flexibility we've got around management of vacancies. You know, we reckon there will always be vacancy management going on. It also reflects the control that we have around the reserves and board earmarks, recognising delays in the normal events of the board. You know, I guess inevitably workforce will be one of the key areas, just recognising the normal pattern.
That all sounds very nebulous.
I think the experience of the board over the years is that we have a higher level of non-recurring savings than we would want to have, and certainly there's an ambition there to ensure that we get a higher level. Certainly it'd be more encouraging if the level of savings that we deliver in 17-18 is higher than the 50% that we're indicating, because that would then have a significant benefit in the years going forward and would assist that the overall delivery of the return of the brokerage.
I mean, it seems to me 50-odd million pounds, leaving aside the property, assuming you get that, 50-odd million pounds is a huge sum to take from non-recurring. And I hear what you're saying about delaying filling posts and all the rest of it. Some of the stuff didn't really make much sense, to be honest. But the fact is, this is more than challenging. And you're going to, after the year five, even if all this works out for you, how long are you going to be able to continue this? You're not showing any improvement at all in the last 3 years. It still sits at 40%. It's not sustainable.
Well, I think we probably made a small step change this year. So in 2015-16, we reported a 35% delivery of recurring savings. This year, we'll be reporting 40% recurring savings. There is an ambition as part of the financial plan, and we do believe it's realistic to deliver a 50-50 split in 17-18. So we are taking those steps forward. Clearly, it would be beneficial if that step change in 17-18 was even greater than 50-50, because I say that would help the position going forward.
A business like this, it's not sustainable. It's not how it works. It's not how it succeeds. You can't have this level of non-recurring costs.
And that's certainly the ambition to ensure that the level of recurring savings delivered by the board is as great as it can be.
It's fine, but there's nothing in here that shows me how you're going to achieve it.
Perhaps that's a comment for him.
I don't think any of us would disagree with you. We understand the size and scale of this challenge that we have, and we're trying to be realistic, and when we say something, that we deliver against that. We know the importance of that. It also recognises that in terms of the 5 years, the service redesign, there's a level of planning and redesign work. You end up in a kind of slightly double running as well, as you're testing things and piloting them. And then once you move, so I gave that example around the dementia model, where it's the right thing to do to provide community dementia care at home, earlier identification, prevention, and then you improve people's quality of life who have that illness. But while you're developing those community models, you've still got your historical inpatient costs, and costs are fixed costs.
Non-recurring savings.
I think as we go through, as these service redesigns and the new services are implemented, we will be able to release recurring cost out the system. Now we're forecasting in 5 years. I think
but
we've talked about the risk.
But you're projecting recurring costs already. Now you're sort of conflating non-recurring and recurring. I mean, it seems to me that for non-recurring costs, what you've done is you've estimated you're going to save so much, and then the difficult bits you've just lumped into non-recurring costs and hope for the best.
Well, our view would be that the five-year plan will be assessed every single year. So the progress we've made in 16-17 is part of the kind of five-year projection there forward in that kind of five-year cycle. So we will look at our delivery in 17-18 and reassess the ability to whether we can increase it. We know the importance of it, and if we are confident or we believe we've got the plans that will allow us to increase our recurring efficiency, then the board will absolutely take that decision. But at this moment in time, given at the base that we've started from, what we are endeavouring to ensure is that if we say we're doing this, that we do deliver against that.
You know, this is just a finger in the air as far as these costs are concerned, these savings are concerned for non-recurring. Is it possible to maybe ask for a breakdown of where these non-recurring costs are going to be achieved?
Yes. I think if you can provide us with that, Mrs. McLay, is that possible? That would be great. You finished, Mrs. Beattie? Thank you. Mr. Bedford, your financial year ends next week, is that right?
It ends tomorrow.
Yes. And you... at that point, will be owed the Scottish Government more than all the other health boards in Scotland combined. Is that right?
It will be the nearest board to us. It will be NHS 24, which is a board that is significantly smaller than the NHS Tayside,
which had huge problems with its IT system, and I think indeed a lot of its debt is due to that. The projections you've given us also in your five-year change programme at page 30, I touched on this earlier, indicate that 2.6 million of that loan from the Scottish Government you don't expect to repay. Is that correct?
The forecast shows the draft position over the five-year period, so it only takes it up to 2021-22. As we've referenced probably a number of times this morning, clearly we are clear about the 2017-18 budget. and the uplifts and the implications of that. Going forward, then it is less clear. You're also, and sorry, the other thing I would also add is that the current plan makes no assessment whatsoever of the Scottish Government moving the board closer to its target share of parity. So currently we're £7 million away from the target share. We were £50 million away from the refinement of the NRAC model and following an £8 million additional investment in 17-18, that moves us £7 million. So the assessment throughout that whole five-year plan is that the Scottish Government will not be able to take us any closer to that parity figure. So £7 million, if the Scottish Government were able to take us closer to parity, then that would give us additional recurring resources year on year. So that's not factored in at all into the plan.
Just to clarify for that, if they were to give you parity as you describe it, how much money would that involve?
It's £7 million per annum, £6.8 million per annum.
That would solve the financial problems of NHS Tayside?
It would support it, yeah.
Okay. But as of tomorrow, you're still owe the Scottish Government £33.2 million.
Yes.
So... But £7 million per year would solve that.
I was going to ask about the director.
That would be assuming that there would be no spiralling costs at all, would it not, if my maths are roughly correct?
So, convener, just to make members aware that the area that we're touching on at the moment is an area, and including Mr Neil from his experience, that will understand the complexities of the NRAC formula and the way in which the allocation is used, and certainly as a clinician I'm not near to that, but there's been representations to me from the clinical community where they do not understand why Tayside is not on parity with the rest of Scotland, and they recognise that the NRAC allocation prospectively is against 2013-14 calculations and have legitimately asked the question, what has Tayside's financial position been against parity since that 2013-14 position, and what have been the consequences of that. So just to make you aware, that's coming through the clinical community, and they'll bring that to me as the medical director, but clearly we're not the right people to provide an explanation. Well, I'm not the right person to provide an explanation.
Okay. I mean, as well as scrutinising, this committee wants to do everything it can to make sure that you can get back to financial sustainability without cutting services. So perhaps that's something that we can take up with Mr Gray as well to get clarification on why that parity isn't coming as you describe it. But if I can go back to the 2.6 million that is not, is unlikely to be repaid. Mr Bedford, is that likely? We talked about the 5 million high risk savings, we talked about the 12 million, Liam Kerr did, the 12 million medium risk savings. I mean, what would you say to the people of Tayside? Is NHS Tayside still going to be in debt at the end of these 5 years to the Scottish Government?
Clearly, the ambition is to repay that level of the outstanding brokerage as quickly as possible, but also as safely as possible. The assumption planning at the moment identifies that a very small amount will be left outstanding at the end of 2021-22, and obviously that would, on the assumptions that a reasonable level of savings are delivered in year six of the plan, then that would repay the entire outstanding balance.
What would repay that entire outstanding?
So by the time we get to year six of the plan, what we showed is a five-year plan. If we extended that out, then you would see the position being repaid in full.
After six years. I mean, yeah. You'll forgive me for probing you further on this, because it was on the 15th of December in front of this committee that Professor Connell said, our plans for the next 5 years, which include the full repayment of any outstanding brokerage over that period of time. Now, that's less than 6 months ago. And, you know, less than 6 months later, we're now seeing that you're projecting that that money will not be repaid. And I'm concerned about services
and jobs in NHS Tayside, and we've looked at high risk and medium risk savings totaling 17 million now. So if in, what's it, 4 or 5 months since Professor Connell said that money will be paid back at the end of 5 years, we're already saying that 2.6 million won't be, and we've identified £17 million worth of savings that are really risky for this year. Is it credible for you to tell me that this money will be paid back?
If I can pick that up, you're absolutely correct that it was our ambition in December that we would have a five-year plan that would fully repay the brokerage. Now, obviously, since then, for the reasons we've discussed, the brokerage has increased by 1.5 million. That places an extra challenge over that five-year period. Also factored in since then has been an understanding of what the revenue resource limit coming down from Scottish Government will be in this financial year, with no certainty over what will come in future years. So Mr. Bedford, I think, has created a relatively conservative assumption over the level of resource that will be available over that period of time, which is probably more conservative than we had anticipated prior to our meeting in December, which was before the Scottish Government's budget allocation. So I think it's against that revised understanding of what we might expect to have financially, and perhaps a revised understanding of the financial pressures in the system, that we've now got a level of brokerage that is, if the plan were to be delivered in fruition, would still be around 2.6 million at the end of 5 years.
Okay, so that 2.6 would still be outstanding?
If the plan is delivered, as outlined, yes.
Okay.
But as we've agreed, none of us can predict at present what the resource limit will be in 5 years' time.
Can I, do members have any further questions for the witnesses? Can I thank you, Mr. Bedford, you'd like to...
Clarification, yes, to your point about effective prevention. If you go look at page 50 of the one-year financial plan, you'll see as part of the outcomes framework resources that we receive from Scottish Government, there's a line on the right-hand side of the table, effective prevention bundle. So we get approximately 3.3 million in resource for the effective prevention bundle, and it includes items such as the sexual health and bloodborne virus, child healthy weight, adult healthy weight, and smoking cessation. So there is 3.3 million that comes to the board in relation to effective prevention.
Liam Kerr.
A quick final question that I think people want to know. What happens if this doesn't work? What happens in 5 years' time if all of the plans, all of the savings, the efficiencies don't work? What happens to NHS Tayside, its patients, and its staff?
Okay. I think it would be appropriate to assure the people of Tayside that NHS Tayside, whatever happens, will still continue to deliver safe and effective care. Now, clearly, how that is managed financially, if this plan is not delivering in the way it's anticipated, will involve ongoing and further discussion with the Scottish Government Health Department. But the NHS in Scotland has a principle that it will maintain healthcare services.
Thank you.
Can I thank you all very much indeed for your evidence this morning? I'm now going to move the committee into private session and suspend for 5 minutes. Thank you.